So my name is David Sankel. I'm from Stellar Science. The title of this talk is The Intellectual Ascent to Agda. Who knows what Agda is?
Some programming.
Couple, yeah, well, maybe.
Some guy told me about it last night. It wasn't real specific.
Yeah. Well, here's the thing. So what we're going to talk about is a technique for development of APIs that when you develop it, it'll be simple, it'll be clear, it'll be pure. But more than that, it'll take purity to the extreme so that when you look at the interface and you look at the different things that are available in your interface to whatever your API is, we start to approach a level of perfection where you look at the interface and you say, I don't know if I can get any more clear or more perfect than that. And I really think this is a game changer. So I could just tell you what it is, but I'd rather that you guys could sort of come along with me to develop this kind of thing yourself. So, let's see, next slide. All right, we got two C++ programs here up on the screen. Are they the same program?
I think both of them are going to fail to link because you don't have a main method.
These are linking to something else that has main. But are these two programs the same?
As far as we can tell.
Yeah, right? I mean, and we can say that, I mean, you can't see the spaces and the returns in here, but we'll assume that they both are empty and just have, like, end of file. They're the same, right? Diff, the diff program will tell you there's no differences, right? So they're diff same.
I'm not going to be tricked. It's white space.
Okay, what about these two programs? Are these the same program? Okay, I heard some yeses and I heard some noes. So why not? Why aren't these the same program?
Yes, it is.
Okay, everybody thinks they're the same program. But diff says they're not the same program though, right? Diff will say, this is different than that. So how are these the same? What's that? They have equivalent behavior. You run these two programs and they both output the same thing, right? So the diff of the output's going to be the same. Yeah?
The AST is the same.
The AST is the same. That's right. These are, so the syntax is the same, the syntax tree. So they're syntactically equivalent, these two programs. Right? You look at the syntax tree, there should be no difference.
Yes.
So we can say that they're syntactically equivalent, even though the exact representation is different, they're syntactically equivalent. And that's what we're going to play around, is this equivalence idea here. So, are these two programs the same?
What language is the right one in?
The right one's in Python. Okay, and for those of you who don't know Python, if you use print, it will add a new line. Okay, so are these two programs the same?
Semantically, sure.
Semantically? Okay, they're not syntactically equivalent, right? They're completely different syntax trees. You can't even compare them.
What's the return value of the script?
What's the return value of the script? I don't know. The same.
Zero. Main implicitly returns zero.
What happens if you can't write to send it out?
Good question. Right? Does that change the whether or not these two programs are equivalent?
Left side, they have different error handling.
Yeah, the question was, what if they can't write to standard out? You know, are these going to be, are these does that change whether or not these two programs are equivalent? Well, yeah, they're still equivalent, all right? Hand wavy. All right, how about these two programs? So these are obviously not syntactically equivalent. You look at the syntax trees, they're different, right? Except here we can't just say, oh, the output's the same. These two programs must be the same. These programs don't have any output, right? So are they the same?
Yes.
I heard a no and a yes.
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 Okay, they're the same, but like in what way? Right, okay. So what we're doing when we look at these two programs and we see that they're the same, this is sort of, maybe you aren't doing this, but this is what I do, is we're building an internal mental representation of this program, and we're building a mental representation of this program, and in our mental representation we can say that these two are the same, right? But that's not very helpful, because if you say they're the same and someone else says they're not, well, You know, if you're just comparing your mental representations, that's not going to be very good. It would be nice if we could get that mental representation in a way that's communicable to other people, right? We want to get it down, the mental representation of equivalence. So ideally, whatever this representation is, we want to have strong equivalence properties. We want to say that this program, you know, whatever the representation is, can be equivalent to this other program in a very strong sense, right? We want it to be able to be written down so I can hand it to somebody. And we'd like a set of rules that we could apply to any program to get this essence of it and then compare the essences. So does anybody have an idea what would be a good intermediate language that we can convert to that has these strong equivalent properties? What's that? Cock? Yeah. Heard scheme. How about something really more basic? How about math, right? Math, we have strong equivalence. 3 plus 2 equals 5, and 5 equals 3 plus 2. I mean, there is no difference between this and this in math. They are equivalent. So what people did is Dana Scott and Christopher Strachey in the late 1960s said, hey, wouldn't it be nice if we could convert all of our computer programs into math? And these guys were talking really old languages here. They, you know, C++, not even close. And they came up with a structure, and it's called denotational semantics. So here we have this function called mu, and you use these funny brackets. So in here is the syntax. Mu of this expression plus this expression. And you can think of mu as the meaning function. So the meaning of an expression plus an expression equals the meaning of the first expression plus the meaning of the second expression, you know, where e sub I is an expression. And the meaning of I equals I, where I is an integer. Right, so here we have this very basic subset of C++ expressions. Yeah?
So what is on the left side, the E1 plus E2, that plus is the plus in the language of choice. And on the right-hand side, the plus is mathematical plus.
Yes. So there was a
different pluses.
Yes. Yeah, so it was a great comment that this plus is different than this plus. This plus is in the syntax, this plus is in the semantics. That one is a math plus, the other one is a syntax plus.
It's not, I'm thinking it's not the syntax plus of, it's more like statement. It's that plus. Like, is it really plus in C++? Or is it, I have an expression and another expression. It doesn't matter if I'm adding them or not, I just have two expressions in my code. They could be different lines of code, or is it really the plus operation?
So the question is this really the plus operation, or?
I guess it's really the plus operation. I see what you're saying.
Okay. Good, because I'm not really sure I understood what you said. So, okay, here we have this denotational semantics. It's beautiful. We just map it to math. Really easy, right? So what is the meaning of this in math? So what's a mathematical representation of this sucker? We want to be able to write it down. We want to have the strong equivalence properties. Well, we could do this in a few ways, right? So we could represent a function as a set of pairs, a pair from whatever the input type is to the output type, like this. So we see 0 maps to 45, negative 1 maps to 44, 1 to 46, dot, dot, dot. You get the idea. Or you could write this as a lambda equation. So lambda c, c plus 5. So lambdas are mathematical representations. So we're on the math side here. And for those of you who aren't familiar with lambdas, just think of this as an anonymous function where the input parameter is c and the result is c plus 5. Does anybody have trouble with this syntax? Because we're going to use more of it. Yes?
By the way, your pairs are wrong.
My pairs are wrong. Good point. Thank you. Yes, something's wrong here. My bad. So, or we could use like this typical mathematical notation, f of c equals c plus 5. So that's great. So functions map well. What about this? What's the meaning of this?
Spin loop.
spin loop, right? That's not a mathematical thing that we can write down. So infinite recursion, I mean, how do we write this down? Right, so this is the problem that these guys, when they were working on denotational semantics, tried to figure out. We need to augment our math. Our math, just our basic grade school math, is not enough to capture all the stuff that happens in programs. So the answer to this is bottom. So they introduced a new symbol, this guy, which means bottom. So if you have a function like this and you want to map it to math, you say that that function maps any integer to bottom. Okay, and this is just a sampling of the kind of things that they needed to do to do this kind of thing. So there was this paper written at about the same time as these people were coming up with this denotational semantics. And Landon wrote about his programming language, and it's called If You See What I Mean. And what he was trying to do is he said, hey, let's make a programming language out of math. So this is a snippet of his programming language. It was never an actual language. It was always just some kind of thing in the paper to inspire people. And so here's an example of the program. This looks a lot like math. You know, f of this plus f of this, where f of x equals that. Does anybody recognize this in a modern programming language, that kind of syntax? Haskell, exactly. So this paper was the basis of a whole stream of languages that were intended to try to say, let's write our programs in math. Let's not care about runtime, about how to execute registers, about how to allocate memory. Let's just write it in math and then see if we can have the compiler, or initially the interpreter, figure this sucker out. So that's where this comes from. And we have these two fields, and it's kind of interesting because Landon, I think this is before denotational semantics came about, so it's interesting they called it If You See What I Mean, because denotational semantics is all about the meaning of things. So here we have math augmented with enough stuff to talk about the meaning. Here we got this guy saying, hey, let's program directly in math. And sort of a side comment about this is when people talk about monoids and monads and how terrible these names are in Haskell, they're sort of missing the point, right? Haskell is about writing in math. So it should be no surprise that they're going to use concepts from math. So like monads come from category theory, right? These are well-defined mathematical constructs. So their programming language is going to be littered with them. That's just how it is. So, great, we can program in math. Why not just drop C++ and write in Haskell? Are you guys all convinced? Because I can just leave now if you think that we should program in Haskell now.
I usually don't encourage people to explain why I should drop C++ and program in Haskell. That's the only reason why I'm not saying anything.
Okay. Any ideas?
I think we have reason to preserve the
Okay, so the comment is that Haskell totally gets rid of side effects, so we shouldn't do that.
Side effects happen in real world, right?
What's that?
Side effects happen in real world.
Side effects happen in the real world. Haskell doesn't handle side effects. So the answer to that is, we do have. So the invention of the monad was a way to handle side effects. So that argument doesn't work.
But that's an ugly workaround. Seriously.
Okay. Let's take another question.
I'd say that C++ maps to a machine model, and that has, you know, good things. And Haskell maps to math, and that has good things. But those are two very different things.
Yes. So we care about writing at the level of the machine, right? Why? I just did a quick check. I grabbed your beautiful Haskell implementation of Quicksort. So you can get this on the internet. And I just grabbed the first implementation of Quicksort I could find in C++. And I ran them on 160,000 ints, and the Haskell program was this fast, or took this long, and the C++ program took this long, just like that. So performance is a factor. Now, of course, someone's going to say, oh, that's not fair, you know, you just can't do that. You can optimize the Haskell. Yes, you can. Right? You could probably optimize this Haskell to be the level of the C++. But what do you lose? You lose the whole point of Haskell in the first place, writing in math. It becomes to look like an imperative language, like you're writing for the machine. So if you program in Haskell like it's C++, you lose what's beautiful about Haskell. And the optimization stuff just isn't there yet. You can't just write in beautiful math and assume it's going to run fast. So here's a picture of languages. So this guy over here is assembly. Can you get the job done? You can eat and you can get food and you can do that. And then you have this whole range of problems. And this guy's C++. He can go all the way to the slower level. And then over here, you've got your Haskell guy. So he's up there. He can solve a certain class of problems up here, but he can't get low enough to solve these kinds of problems. The C++ guy straddles that area. And then all the way on the right here, we have Agda, which we'll talk about. So where does Java fit in this picture? Let me just say that if C++ were to pass gas, I would not want to be where Java's sitting. Okay, so we have this denotational semantics, and this guy, Connell Elliott, is a master semanticist. He's made a ton of beautiful APIs using a very interesting idea. And what he does is he designs his semantics in Haskell without regard to performance. So he will come up with a mathematical model of whatever the domain happens to be without considering anything about performance. Just what's the most pure? What's the essence of the problem? And of course, that in Haskell is not going to be fast, right? In any language, it's not going to be fast because we're talking about things like real numbers when you get to this level. Now, then he takes that, those semantics in Haskell, and he derives a speedy implementation also in Haskell based on the semantics he made without consideration of performance. Now, so his mathematical language is Haskell and his implementation of language is Haskell. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to extend C++'s leg out that way towards more powerful by saying, we're going to go beyond Haskell for our semantic language. And actually, we need to, because what you can do in C++ is fundamentally more powerful than what you can do in Haskell in an abstraction level. So let's talk about Agda. Agda is something, it has many amazing qualities. It's extremely beautiful. It takes programming to the next level. In fact, it took the type system so powerful a level that it merged these two fields, and there's no difference between a theorem-proving assistant and a programming language. They become equivalent when you get to a high enough level. So Agda is a theorem prover and it's a programming language all in the same bundle. Now Agda, like I said, is way over here. So the runtime performance is going to be, I don't even think people know what the runtime performance is because nobody actually writes real programs in Agda. People have done real proofs in it, but they haven't written programs. Because if you're at that math level, you don't care about those things, like an actual execution. So, you know, people would just discard it as a research language or whatever. But we're going to learn it, right? Because we don't need to program in Agda. We're going to do this reverse denotational semantics type thing. Okay, I use the word reverse loosely. We're going to come from a math, and then we're going to derive our implementation in C++. So let's see why Agda is awesome. So here we have types. So A is of type int. This is the syntax that Agda uses to say that A has this type. Does that make sense? Oh, please tell me it makes sense. Okay. And then we can say A is equal to 5, just like Haskell. So if we use Agda as the semantic domain for C++ expressions, we can say that the meaning of 3 plus 2, so 3 plus 2 is our C++ abstract syntax tree, is equal to 5 in Agda. The meaning of 3 plus 2's type in Agda is int. The meaning of any C++ expression plus any C++ expression, well, we'll assume these are int expressions, the type of that meaning is always going to be int. Okay, moving up. So functions in Agda. We use this syntax, A arrow B. So that's a type. We say that A arrow B is the type of functions with input A of type A and output of type B. So here we have a function that takes in a char and returns 4. This is C++ syntax. In Agda, we would say f has type char arrow int f of c equals 4. So we take in our arguments to our function in where it's defined as opposed to up in the type. So the type is very separated from the implementation. And we use the syntax. Now, just to sort of something to wrap your head around is, when we call a function, we don't do it like you do in C++, where you put the arguments in parentheses. You just put it right after. So again, those familiar with Haskell, this is going to be the same. And multiple parameter function types are written like this. So this is a function type that takes in a char and an int and returns a char. Now, there's a lot of reason behind that, but we're not going to go into that. It's just that's how it's done. So far, this is actually equivalent to Haskell. Like, we haven't done anything more interesting yet. So here we have pairs in Agda. So A cross B is a type where the first element has type A and the second element has type B. It's also called a product type. So instead of writing standard pair AB, we would just write A cross B. That's that type. And a value of that pair type is written just with parentheses and a comma in it. So now we have some denotational semantics. We have some stuff we can do. What can we say about a standard pair of type A and type B? That maps to, and we're using T to say we're in the type context, because if you're in a value context and you do that expression, it's different. Is the meaning of A cross the meaning of B? All right, so we're mapping the pair type in C++ to the pair type in Agda. Does that make sense so far? Okay. Let's move on. Now let's talk about magic. So Agda, types have a type. Okay? Int has a type. Well, it's actually called a universe, but we can think of them as types. So the type of int is set. So think of set as the type of all types. So if we have this function type, a function from int to char, its type or its universe is set. So the next question is, well, what's set's type, right? And set's type is set 1. Can anybody think of why set's type shouldn't be set?
There's no set of all sets.
What's that?
There's no set of all sets.
There's no set of all sets? Right, we run into some hairy contradictions. And you run into it here too. So we have this sort of universe graph. So set is type is set 1, and set 1's type is set 2, and set 2's type is set 3, and so on to infinity. There you go. So that's kind of magical. Now look at this next thing here. Types and values can be mixed. So here we have a function. It takes in an int, and it returns a set. Oops, I should have used a real arrow there. Sorry about that. So and it's called into type. So into type of 0 equals char, into type of anything else equals int. That's kind of a funky thing, right? Taking in an integer and returning a type. So I hear some murmuring about different ideas about how to implement this in C++. So something like this, right? So we have this template. This takes in the int, and int is the result, okay? If it's anything, if it's 0, it maps to char. Yes?
Maybe you're going to get to this, but when you explained that an int that the type of int was set, it made sense to me because I can imagine that it's the set of integers. But then when you said that a function was also a set, it was harder for me to visualize. I wonder if you could sort of give an example of like how we're meant to think about the idea that a type is a set.
Sure. Okay, so the question is how can we understand that a type is a set, like a function or something like that? So think of a type as a bag full of stuff. And that stuff is the elements of that type. So a bag of int, you pull it out, you're going to get like 5. Right? Now, it turns out that int is also in a bag. So you have a bigger bag with int, with char, with all your different function types, and that bag is called set. And set is in a bag called set1. So hopefully that helps.
It means all the possible values.
Yes. Okay, so here...
Sorry, question.
Yes.
What else is in the bag of set one besides set?
So the question is, what else is in the bag of set one besides set? So for example, any function type that includes set. So the function from set to set would be in set one.
Are we going down the same road? Do you know what I'm talking about? Russell's system of types?
Well, right, Russell's paradox.
Yeah, well, that too. And his solution to the paradox was a system of types
that
no one used after he spent years figuring it out.
Okay, so the comment is that Russell's system of types, where we have this sort of set hierarchy, broke down after a while. Are we getting into the same problem over here? The answer to that question is I don't know. I presume not. I think I would have heard about it. So here we are. Here we have this function in C++. We have this function being called in C++. Obviously, the syntax is a little bit heavy compared to the syntax in Agda. Now we got some more magic. Now we have something called dependent types. This is a property of Agda. It's a dependent type language. Ooh, ah. So here we have the meaning of a vector of char. The meaning's type is set, right? Because it's going to map to a type in Agda. So the type of that type is going to be set, right? That's the meaning of that. So what is a vector by itself without its arguments? What's its meaning's type? So it is a function, yes? A function from what?
Function from the type.
It maps two types, a pair of types to a type.
Okay, let's ignore the allocator.
That isn't a type. It's just universal bet.
So how do we so what are we gonna write down here?
Should we set? T to set?
I heard set arrow set. So the meaning of vector by itself, its type is set to set. Takes in a type, returns another type. Yes?
I'm confused with this syntax because previously we used, in the meaning in type context, you then used an equal sign to say, okay, that's the actual type of that thing.
I can
say in the type context and then colon, which I took, that's the type of the type of the thing, which in this case I think should be set one and not set to set.
And a vector that generates a class called vector int.
It's the colon versus inset.
So standard vector of care.
Mm-hmm.
Its meaning is a list.
Or something.
Its type. It's the type of that list is set.
Yes.
Okay, but I think I don't understand you. I might understand you. So the T beside the brackets just means, okay, what's inside the brackets is a type.
And what's inside the brackets is we're talking about in the type context, right? Because I can call this like a constructor and it's going to mean something else.
Okay.
What would happen if you put in like our int to something, into type macro, into vector? Then the type wouldn't fit anymore. Because on the left-hand side of this type set to set, the left-hand set, this should be some universe, some real universe that isn't a type anymore. Because there could be any type.
Okay.
You see vector, you have no condition on what you would put into this vector.
Yes, okay. So.
And now you put on the condition that it has to be a usual type. If you put set to set, you're not allowed anymore to put something like int to type of something.
Okay, so
int to type would be of type
that's true,
int to set, and that doesn't live anymore in set.
Okay, so the question is, you know, is this too limited, right? Is set too limited? Can we put in something else besides a type as the parameter vector? Well, if you try to put in 3, that's not going to compile, right? So you can't put anything as the template argument to vector. You can only put a type. And the bag, which has all the types, is set. OK, so here we have the meaning of standard pair in the type context. Question, yes?
Sorry, as a corollary to his question, could you put a type of set inside the vector? Or inside the template parameter?
Could you put the type of all types as a template parameter to vector?
Yeah.
I don't know how to represent such a thing in C++.
Okay, so it has to. Okay, gotcha.
Actually, yes, you can, because you can instantiate a parameter. You can instantiate a template over a template parameter as an argument, generating a new dependent type. So, yes, you can. As I'm working on GCC right now, I assure you, you can substitute a template parameter, which is a set of all types, conceivably, into a vector and get another specialization out.
Okay, so I'm told by GCC expert that you can actually represent the set of all types. Now, here we have the meaning of the standard pair in the type context. So this is going to take in two parameters, right? You take in two parameters for the pair. Each of those are different types, and it returns a new type. And here we can actually implement that, right? So lambda AB equals A cross B.
So you're still talking about the type there. You still have the T there on there.
Yes.
And what's the difference between the colon and the equals?
So the colon, so the equals means the meaning of this equals that. That is the meaning of that. This is saying the meanings type has this. So you could even think about if this was just f. F's type is that. F is equal to that.
In the type context, you've got the little t locations there.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So now we have standard pair in an expression context. And in an expression context, we have actually 4 arguments. Maybe there's a way you can make a pair without arguments. I don't know. I never used it. Nobody should use that. Let's assume that it has.
It's a language feature in C++.
What's a language feature?
You can declare a variable of type standard pair without supplying arguments. It's automatically deduced from initializer.
Okay. Well, and we have something like make pair, which so the comment was that. So we have the comment that in C++11 we can make a std pair as a type. without having to supply the template parameters. It'll deduce it from the constructor arguments. So in the expression context, we have four arguments, two of them the types, and two of them are the values of that type. And this produces the pair of the first one and the second one. Okay, so we can understand what the meaning of std pair in an expression context is. That's what it is. But now what is std pair's type? The meaning's type, I mean. Yes, right? The key word there is depend. Dependent types, right? That's, we need something special there. So we know that the first two arguments are types. What the heck are the types of those other arguments? They depend on the values of the first two types. So here's how we write that. We say that this takes in a set what its value is. Let's call that T1. This takes in a set. Whatever its value is, let's call that, oh, this was T0. We'll call that T1. And then take in a value of type T0, a value of type T1, and return a pair of T0 cross T1. So we're mixing the values in your type declaration, you know, within it. Okay, this is dependent types. And the thing that's interesting about this is that we just took a normal C++ function here. You know, well, it's a constructor, but it's a normal C++ function. And now we can finally say what its type is. Because we have this power now. We have the syntax. We can show the dependence between the different types of this function here. All right, is everybody okay with this so far? So, we have this dependent function type. Okay, and I'm not using exact Agda syntax here. Okay, the Agda syntax is slightly different, but this is easier, so we'll just go with this. So the general form is x colon t arrow some expression that uses x in it. And this is the dependent function type. So x is any identifier, t is some kind of type, e of x is an expression that uses x in it. So we can take values and use those values to produce part of the type in a function, part of the return function, right? It's kind of hard to mentally wrap your head around it if you're thinking in C++ terms, but in abstract math, that's perfectly fine. So here's another kind of dependent type. Yes, we have a question.
In general, can I assume when you say value, you're not talking the bottom C++ value like 5, but often you're, whatever level you happen to be talking at.
Yes.
You're talking about types. You know, you might, when you say value, and my example might be, well, the value might be int or the value might be char. That's a value because we're up at that level.
Yes.
Or it could be up another level.
Yes.
You
so.
Just always use the word value.
So the comment was that when I'm using the word value, am I referring to the bottom level only? And or am I referring to whatever context you happen to be in that hierarchy of things? And yes, I'm talking about in the hierarchy of things where you happen to be. Good question. So we have another kind of dependent type. This one we have a pair, or our product operator here, where A... This can be like a type, let's say. Let's call it A, and a value of that type. So this is a type and a value. This is a pair of a type and a value of that type. Does that make sense? A question.
Can you just back up one slide real fast for me?
Sure.
How do I, oh, never mind. I got it.
Great.
How do you
How do we map this into C++ you're talking about, this type and value thing?
Yeah.
Good question. How would you map such a thing into C++?
As a template?
As a template? So this, okay, so I don't have a slide for how we represent this as a type, but let's do that real quick. Okay, so we got template, A, there's other stuff in here, typedef A, type, and static, A, value, equals, I don't know, you deal with that. So. That's not scalable. Why?
You have to define letter 1, 2, 3.
We've defined, so.
If there are more things counting, more letters, please.
This is that. These are. So maybe the question is, can you map any Agda thing into C++? And that is unknown.
Any plans?
That's unknown. Okay? Maybe, maybe not. It's something I haven't come up with a counterexample. Okay, so here we have a pair of a type and an element of that type. So here we have a function called make type and value. It takes in a type, let's call it A, takes in a value of that type, yes?
So the type of that then would be set 1. If you looked at like
So this thing,
yeah, is going to be in set 1.
Yes.
Okay. And so any type, so if you have like set 1 arrow set 2, that would be then in set 3.
Yes.
Okay.
So the question was, what is the type of this? The type of this is set 1. If you have something like set 1 arrow set 2, the type of that is going to be set 3. So you can see how typedefs are just, you know, follow straight from the syntax, right? A typedef would just be saying, so typedef A, B, the meaning of that would be, its type would be set to, never mind. But typedef AB is just basically saying B equals A. And the type of that is going to be set. I digress. So back over here, we have a pair, and we can make this type and value, and we're looking at this type. So A is the first argument. We're going to call it A. The second argument needs to be of type A, and the result value is this dependent product type, where we can refer to this is going to be some kind of set. Let's call it B, and it's going to also have as a second part of the pair of that B. Question?
Is there a way to do any kind of type deduction so you can say make type and value, and you just give it a value, and it says the type of that value is what I'm going to use for the tape?
Yes. The question is, and we're going to get to that in the next slide, so I won't repeat the question. Another question?
Isn't the type to lose?
I'm sorry?
Isn't the type of make type and value to lose?
To lose. Oh.
Not constrained enough because, I mean, the function by its definition always returns its first argument as the first element of the tuple.
So the question is this to lose? Can we make a more strict type out of this thing? Yes? Yes, we probably could. Yes, question.
So somewhere I'm losing when we're talking about type as a type, as in the first A you have there. And the type, B is not really the type anymore, but B is actually, for lack of a better word, an instance of the type. The 3 is represented by B, no? B was representing the type.
B. If you consider the value type thing, B's type is set. So this pair, the result value, is going to consist of a type and a value of that type.
I'm a little confused. Like, how is like B is totally unconstrained here. It only appears in the return type.
Yes. So the comment is that B is totally unconstrained. It only returns, shows up in the return type. That's true.
How is, I don't understand.
Just like it was here. So this is the dependent pair is written in this syntax, and you can throw it anywhere in a type.
But shouldn't it depend on the input arguments somehow?
It makes a generic function. I mean, one thing you can do in Haskell is you just write the definition of a function and let the compiler deduce the type.
Yes.
If I were to deduce the type here, under the constraint that T is a type.
So type deduction.
You start with A colon set and A as argument type. The return type for me would be set X A if I were to deduce this from the definition.
Okay, so the comment is that you can deduce the definition of this in Haskell and it's going to come up with an answer. In Agda, what's really more interesting is to deduce the value. But that's undecidable, and trying to deduce the type is also undecidable. And to deduce that the value matches the type is actually undecidable.
So what's the point of the type?
What's the point of the type, right? You use the decidable subset, and you annotate it to, if you wanted to use Agda for Agda, there's a large subset that is decidable, so that's the part we care about. Yes, question.
Sorry, can you go back to the previous slide?
Sure.
So can you explain why this in make type and value when you define the type, why it's not, like why the B's are there instead of A's? Like I would think it would be A colon set arrow A to, you know, A colon set cross A. Is that not, can you explain that? Like why they're B's? I guess I'm confused for the same reasons.
Okay, so I could have made this return value instead. How could I have made this return value? This returns a value of that type. Yeah, it could have just been... Oh, I'm getting confused. My brain has popped. This is okay. I tested this in Agda, so this is valid.
You can restrict
this further. Yes. All right. Now, this is a little bit easier to grasp. So, std pairs meaning require these four different parameters, right? Make pair also has the four parameters. Well, let's assume that we're not forgetting, we're going to ignore perfect forwarding and all this kind of stuff. It needs two types and two values of those types. But these two can really be deduced, right? The template arguments can be deduced based on what you send into the function. So we use this curly bracket notation to say that that's a real parameter, but do your best to deduce that from the other parameters. So if we call this function in Agda, we don't send in these. You can, you know, force it to send in these, but you would just send in these two values, and these two will be deduced. All right, so we good so far?
This way is much better than Haskell.
This way is much better than Haskell is a comment.
Yes.
Haskell's old stuff, man. All right, so denotational semantics. Now let's do this denotational designs. So Connell Elliott, the denotational design master, he would sit and he'd mull over and he'd say, what is a movie in math? What's a mathematical representation of a movie in the most abstract way you can possibly imagine?
A
sequence
of frames.
A sequence of frames. Great. So we have a list of frames. Okay?
data addition, like the title of the movie, who was in it.
Okay, so, but you know what? That stuff is, there.
Yeah, you do need to know the frame rate.
You need to know the frame rate. Okay, so we have a rate maybe, so we have a frames, we have a rate.
I guess what do you mean? A movie is the name, the producer, and descriptions or maybe.
So the comment is a name and a producer and all that kind of stuff, but we can add that stuff to movies, right? We could just say, this is a movie and a list of strings. Right, so what's the movie part? What's the real essence of movie? So we have a list of frames, but what about a movie that doesn't have frames?
Yes, that is what I mean. You only need the name to end, like.
What about those GIF videos? You know, that they repeat over and over and you keep on waiting for them to end, but they don't? This representation doesn't capture that. Okay, a stream of frames? Okay. So now we're allowing this list of frames to be infinite. Okay, that's perfectly valid. What about a movie of a ball circling around? I don't need to specify the frame rate. Right, what happens if we pull out frames? What do you get?
Continuous function.
A continuous function, now we're talking. Okay, from what to what? Okay, from time to coordinates. So time is what?
Continuous.
Time is continuous, but what's a mathematical type for time?
Reals.
So here, this is cool. Now we can have movies that extend to negative infinity and a positive infinity. Why not? Right? Let's not restrict ourselves. And we have a function from time to some other thing, right? But why restrict ourselves to what this other thing is? So here's a movie. The meaning of movie's type takes in one type and goes to another type. And the meaning of movie is a function which takes in some kind of type and returns a function from R to that type. So we can have an int movie. Yes?
I worked on Adobe Premiere for 10 years. And I tried to convince them this is how, like exactly this. Just like, why are you always talking about frames? Why are you talking about durations? Because some things don't have duration. And why can't I have a movie that just has metadata? It has no frames. It's just supplying the closed captioning, the whatever. Just stuff that happens over time.
Yes. So
got that much of it in the code base, but real quick, had to be more concrete, unfortunately.
I won't repeat that, but that's awesome. So now we have this really pure movie thing. What are some of the operations we have on it? So the meaning of the always operation, this is how you create a movie, is you pass in a value of some kind of type, and it returns a movie of that type. So, and here's the implementation. So if the value is A for any time, it always returns A. So the movie that just has one frame or one picture all the time, you could do that with this always operation. You'd say always, let's say you have a pixmap format, always a value of that pixmap. And now you got a movie that for all time is that pixmap.
The type to the left of the arrow, did you specify that as set because there's no specific type for the set of real numbers? I thought it was set of reals to some type A.
Right, that's where the question is, where is the reals here? Why is this just set? Think of this as a template class, right? So movie of that type is going to have this kind of meaning to it.
Okay.
All right. So.
One question, sir.
Yes.
What does it mean when you say the meaning of movie and then space at A? Is this some kind of operator or?
Here?
No, down.
Down.
One line down.
Here?
Yeah. At the end.
Oh, so I'm just calling the meaning of movie function with A.
Okay.
So just take that and substitute this. Okay, so the question is, what is this meaning here? What is this meaning doing here? And the answer is that you can just substitute the meaning in right there and get your value. So we have this always operation. It's kind of like a fundamental operation based on the mathematics, based on the semantics of this thing. And we have the snapshot function, which is another fundamental operation. It takes in a movie of type A, a value of type R, and produces a value of type A. We're basically saying, give me what the frame is at 0.5, and it will give you the value of that. And we're just calling that movie, because remember, a movie is just a function here. We're calling it with T. That make sense? Okay, that's a movie. Now we can do more interesting functions. You know, we've got this abstract type. We can trim a movie. We can say that I'm going to take a movie. I'm going to make a movie of a boost optional type frame. And any time less than a particular time is going to be none. And any time after is going to be, you know, the filled value of boost optional of whatever that original movie is. So we have this like left trim function. And we can have, now this one's kind of complicated. Here we have a movie of functions. So for every time step, you can pull a function out of it. And you can apply that to a movie of values. And then you get a movie of type B. So a movie of a function from A to B takes, and then a movie of A, and then you get a movie of B. So now we can apply movies of specific formats to each other. So if we make a movie of some complex function, let's say we just want to add more gray to it. We can make a movie of gray, and we can apply that more grayness function to the original movie to make it all more gray. I mean, we're at a very abstract level here, but these are the fundamental operations of a movie. So we can, you know, take these semantics and move them to C++. So assuming we have an implementation of trims and all this kind of stuff, here's a cut in place function. So we take a movie and we cut from this time step to this time step out of it, and then we put it on top of this other movie at a different time step. This function can be defined in terms of those more primitive operations. So this C++ code is completely valid, assuming those other operations are implemented. So we get the left trimmed of the first one, and then we do the right trim of that, so then we get just that section of code, or just that section of movie that we care about. And then we use join, because we got a boost optional, to just get one boost optional. And then we can shift joined to be at the position that we want to start at in the new composed movie. And then we can overlay one movie on top of the other. So if you take this overlay function and you have your optional frame and you just have your normal frame, if this one's none, then we'll just use this normal frame. If this one has a value, then it's going to use that value. So this is denotational design. This is the process. You start out in a powerful mathematical semantic language. You figure out what are the essential elements of whatever your domain is, and then you make an implementation in C++ or something else. I think I just said that. So you try to keep the semantic interface, but you implement it efficiently in C++. So, you know, this interface for movie, if you try to implement that, you're done, because you can't even represent a real in C++ or any language. Well, you can represent some of the reals. But we can refine that and come up with our essential operations. Okay, so that was one example. This is, we started a top-level example trying to understand what a movie is, and we'll then derive our implementation from it. So here's another example. This is some code that I came across. Inspired from some code that I came across. And what we wanted to do is we want to say, what the heck is the meaning of this code? We've got this set ID thing in here. So it's got an ID. It's got a name. It's got the storage from disk functions. It's got this validate function, which takes in geography. And has this calculate ID thing. What is the meaning of this? So when I approach code, that's the question I ask. What is this thing? What's the real essence of what we're getting to here? Turns out this one, there was a different function somewhere else. This is a different function somewhere else. So you inherit from this thing, and you implement the stored disk things. But then there's another function somewhere else where we make this grass measurement. So we have a measurement class, and we have this subclass called grass measurement. And really, the essence of this thing is it takes in a geography, and it returns some kind of value. Okay, all the other stuff is fluff, but it's important fluff, which we'll cover in a minute here. So here's what the meaning of a measurement is, you know, in this context of code. It's a type, and it's a function from a geography to that type. Pretty simple. That's what the meaning of a measurement is. What is a grass measurement? A grass measurement, in the expression context, it takes in a color and it returns a measurement. And a measurement is a function, so it takes in a geography and does some kind of thing with it. Has everybody get this so far? Okay. I'm getting chocolate over myself. So let's implement this in C++. This measurement type. So if you inherit from this, then you're a measurement. It takes in a type name T. So we type def this as the measurement result. That's that. And then we have a function which takes in a geometry and returns that type. That's this. So we're just doing a very direct translation of the semantics here to a C++ implementation. So the difference here is now I'm using the operator overload, and I'm using result type. By doing this, now we're getting to the semantics of a function. I guess if we're in C++11, I don't really need the result type. But when you realize that you just have that kind of a thing, you can just implement it like this. So what about that ID thing? So every single one of these measurements had an ID. And the reason for that was for caching. They didn't want to run the measurement on the geography twice. You want to be able to know if you're going to run it twice. So they have this ID. So we could introduce an ID into here, right? But why wouldn't we want to do that?
Oh, I was going to say the ID is really just a function from measurement to an int.
OK, yeah. So an ID is just a function from a measurement to an int. That's right. But essentially what we're trying to do with these things is we're trying to see if the two functions are the same, right? The ID of a function, if it has a different ID from a different function, then they're different functions. And we have strong equality for functions, not in C++, right? But in math we do. So here, we add an equality operator. So you really didn't need an ID. What you really needed, what the essence of what they were looking for, was to find out if two functions are the same. So part of our measurement thing here, we need to get taken derived class in order to be able to define this operator equals. And this is, it just follows from the semantics. So when you apply semantics to code, you end up seeing these things a lot. Like these other constructs that are doing these weird things are actually just fundamental properties of the meaning of whatever they were trying to get at. So there was also this validation thing. So not all measurements are valid for a particular geography. And like, it doesn't apply. So anybody want to take a stab at what the how we can modify our semantics to handle that? So it doesn't always, so this function here doesn't always have an A.
An optional A.
An optional A, yes. So we modify our semantics, so it returns an optional A. So it doesn't always apply to a given measurement. So now we have optional as our result type. We've modified our implementation. Now, sometimes you want to see if it's valid without having to run the whole measurement operation. That's why the validate procedure was separate in the first place. So, semantically, we don't care about speed ever, right? We have infinite memory, infinite speed, so we don't want to modify our semantics for that kind of thing. But our implementation, we can make this function called returns value, and it means the same thing as calling the operation on your geography and converting it to a bool. And inheritors of this class can overload this if they want to make it more efficient to see if it's valid, to see if it applies to that given geography, as long as it matches this same semantic meaning. So the efficiency considerations, we don't have to modify our semantics, but sometimes we have to modify our interface with a very clear-cut semantic meaning. So where are we at? Does this all make sense, or have we gone off the deep end here? No answers. Oh, it's a couple heads shaking, yes. Okay, good. So the meaning of, you know, M, where M is some kind of measurement, dot returns value of G is equal to just calling that function and seeing whether or not it's filled or not. So that's the meaning of the returns value. So we can define the semantics of that extra function. So now we have our grass measurement thing. We look at our geography and we try to measure our grass. So we know that the meaning of a grass measurement takes in a color and it returns a measurement. And now we inherit from this measurement base class with the two parameters. We need to say what the grass measurement result, and we say, you know, self. And we implement our operator overload. We implement our equality. And here we do our, if the green threshold of one grass measurement is the same as the green threshold of another grass measurement, then they are both the same function. And returns value, overloading that to make it more efficient. And here's the constructor and that member variable. Yes?
So you don't have to add a new returns value method to the interface. So you have your cleaner interface. Would that work?
The question is, can I implement that operator? So instead of using optional, to use some kind of custom optional where you can tell if it's valid without actually having to compute it, sort of like a lazy computed value.
Yes.
And the answer is yes, that's perfectly valid, right? That may make this a lot simpler. So that brings up a good point, is when you derive your implementation from your semantics, you have a lot of choices, right? And you want to have those choices. It's gonna be important what choices you make. So we got serialization. Do we need to change our semantics to implement serialization?
Yeah,
What do you guys think? Do we need to change this in order to be able to store it to a file? I see a head shaking no. Why not?
Because basically, as long as the set, as we can, we know what data and measurement contains, if we can just write that out, it's serialized.
Right, in math, we don't care about serialization, right?
It's just representation.
Sure, functions can be serialized. What does that mean? You know, it's. The comment is that we need to have the objects to be identical in order to serialize them. I'm not sure I understand what that means, but in the semantics, sure, you can store a function out to file. Just store every single input-output pair, right? We have infinite space. We don't care about that. So in this case, just use boost serialization for all the subclasses and make an any measurement type. So now we want a type which holds all the measurements, right? But we know that we can't do that in C++, right? Because that's just too big. So we're really going to do a subset, but that's OK, because we can do subsets when we do our implementation of our semantics. So here we have a boost MPL set of these different types. All right, so we have a grass measurement, another measurement, and so on. And we use boost make variant over these measurement types, and now we have this any measurement structure. Is that pretty straightforward? Okay. And we can serialize that just fine. But interesting that any measurement looks a lot like a measurement, doesn't it? So if we have either this or this or this or this, that whole structure itself is a measurement. But we need to figure out what the result type is. So what's the result type of any measurement? Well, it's going to be any measurement result. So we have a variant. So we take each of the measurements, we look at the result type. Okay, now we have a list of all the measurement result types. And now we make a variant over that, and now we have any measurement result. And here's the implementation of the any measurement type. We just use boost apply visitor for all the different things, and that'll work just fine. And we can now have any measurement is also a measurement. So we're reusing our semantics here, or our base class, to even include all measurements. So if you look at the semantics, you might say, okay, what other kind of operations can you do on these semantics? Well, you can join measurements. Right, if you have two measurements, you can make a new measurement out of them both. The return value is just going to be the pair of the return values of each of the individual ones. We could have a map function, which will take a function from A to B and a measurement of A and return a measurement of B. These are all perfectly valid in our semantics. And here I'm just defining result of, so result of in C++ is some complicated beast. Here is very simple. So the idea is that when you use these semantics, you get these really beautiful and powerful APIs. Like here we have some kind of grass and rocks measurement. You know, and we map this function onto the joining of these other two measurements. And this whole thing produces a new measurement. You have these simple operations that you can compose things with. And here's just sort of an example of it here. Okay. So back to the end, or the beginning, to the end. What you do is you discover the essence of your problem in a high-level mathematical language, like math augmented with Agda constructs. And then you derive your implementation based on that. or at least your API, based on this high-level understanding of it. That's the essence of denotational design, and this can be applied to C++. And I think it would make a huge difference in the kind of code that's developed if we use this kind of mentality as opposed to like UML or something like that. So we have like 15 minutes left, so open up to questions, comments. To see if it's consistent? Yes. So the question is, can we check our semantics in some kind of way to make sure it's consistent? And yes, you could use the Agda program, which is like built in to Emacs, I think is how they did it, and make sure that everything is consistent. And that's something I do often. It's very nice to do that. Good question. Any other questions?
If I'm understanding you right, so I've been sort of following through the presentation and it all makes sense, my question is in my head is what does this give me? So I'll just posit what I think it gives me. Let's say I'm writing an operating system to run a nuclear power plant. If I were to annotate up my implementation for that operating system using this and ensuring a one-to-one mapping between the C++ and the Agda, that could give me the ability to formally verify that that operating system for nuclear power plants is correct in the strongest sense of the word. Is this what it gives me?
The question is, does this give you a way to verify your implementations by annotating them with the semantics? And the answer is yes.
Okay.
Yes. You can prove that your code matches the semantics correctly.
You still have to write the C++ by hand, right?
Yes.
And you can make a mistake.
Yes. So the comment is that you can still write the C++ code by hand and make a mistake. And that's true. Like you can make a mistake in your implementation. Anybody can do that. But at least you have a formal way to say that this is correct. Someone else can look at it and do the proof.
Well, that presumes that the mapping is proven to be correct and that the subset of C++ that you're mapping into is also proven to be correct.
Okay, so there's the comment is that the C++ itself could not be correct, or maybe the compiler has a bug, or maybe you're not taking into consideration cosmic rays which hurt your hard drive. So yes, that's true, but not very interesting at the same time. Yes, yes. So there's a big body of research on compiler systems to try to verify, like have verified compilers, and that's true. Absolutely. Yes.
On that theme, I think the unit test would get you pretty far. For here's my concept, my meaning, semantic meaning. Here's my implementation of just that one little part. I unit test the heck out of it, and then at least I have some confidence that I translated correctly into C++. And then the bigger picture of does it all fit together properly, I can do at the semantic level.
So the comment was that you can verify your lower level constructs that have semantic meaning using unit tests to get a strong confidence in them, and then at the higher level, when you put those together, you can use your semantic meaning for the verification of that, and that's absolutely correct.
So what we then need is basically a quick check that takes Agda input and outputs C++ unit tests.
The comment was that we need a quick check program which takes an Agda and outputs C++ unit tests. I would love for you to do that. Thank you.
One further question. Could you comment on what the difference or similarities this has to a formal specification language like Z?
Okay, the question is, what is the difference between this and a formal specification language like Z?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm not familiar with Z. So I'm sort of going on a limb here. I don't really know the answer to that question, except that this is a formal language, like Z is, except it's based in mathematical constructs. So that would be.
So
what do I do in Actor if I want to constrain types to some subset of types? So basically, when I have a template in C++ and I say, okay, and my template parameter needs to be a forward iterator, something like concepts in C++, how would I express such a thing in Agda?
So the question is, how would you express something like a concept in Agda?
Yes.
And the answer to that is a function. So if you can have a function which takes in a, like, let's say I is the thing you want to say is an iterator, what this does is it'll take in your thing and will prove that it's an iterator. And this is the witness of that. So given an I, show that it has all the iterator functions. So concepts map to just functions. And this is approaching the area where Agda becomes a theorem assistant as well. Awesome job. I just learned a lot about it yesterday. Concepts are functions, and that's how that works.
And how do you express the constraint on another function?
So the other function, so it takes in a set and a proof,
yes,
that it is an iterator and does something. And this argument can be automatically deduced.
What's the process for validating the correctness of an Agda program?
So what is the process for validating the correctness of an Agda program? To make sure that your types are consistent with your values.
Oh, okay.
Any other questions? Comments?
What's the difference between that and type safety?
What is the difference between that and type safety? What is type safety?
Oh, like type checking, like the compiler?
Okay, so the question is, what is the difference between that and type checking a compiler? And I mean, that's exactly what it is, except it's incredibly, incredibly hard to see if this matches that type.
Okay.
And sometimes you need to, if you're doing really complex things, but like, not complex things that you think would be complex. The things that you would normally think are complex are simple. But the things that are complex in Agda, you have to really do some work.
So that's the C++ equivalent of type checking, basically.
Yes,
okay.
That is the C++ equivalent of type checking.
Okay.
All right, so that's it.